Okay, so we were talking about what it was like as a kid, and finally you got your own place at 18?
Yes.
And then how long, and then you lost that place. In your other video you said you lost that place.
Yeah, so you 3 years after being in there, I lost it.
So you definitely had some struggles.
Yeah, most definitely.
And you're only 23.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
I'll be 23 in a couple of hours, because I'm not 23 yet. I'll be 23 on Friday, so.
Okay.
When it's Mr. Friday, I'm going to be partying.
Nice. So when you got your diagnosis, what made you go get tested?
Pretty much, I was working a very stressful job, and this is the one time that I was actually stressing, because I worked for AT&T, which was a very stressful job.
Mm-hmm.
But I started to notice that a lot of things right with me. I mean, gums started bleeding. I mean, I was having all kind of health problems, throwing up, you know, diarrhea, all kinds of stuff. So I just knew something wasn't right.
Mm-hmm.
So I started researching online, you know, about HIV and seeing some of the symptoms. So I'm like, you know what? I need to go get tested.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, I pretty much went and got tested from there, because I knew something wasn't right. But, I mean, in my head, I pretty much told myself that I was positive before I even went to go get tested.
Why did you tell yourself you were positive?
Because, like I said, I looked at the, I knew I never had no problems like that before.
Mm-hmm.
And, like I said, I pretty much looked at the symptoms and knew just something wasn't right. And because of a person that I was dealing with, we were protected, but I had a hunch that the condom broke, but I didn't ask, which wasn't smart. But, I mean, something in the back of my head just kept telling me, you know what? Something ain't right.
Right.
Mm-hmm. So.
So when they gave you the results, what went through your mind?
The first thing that went through my head is, wow, not me. Like, why is this happening to me? This can't be right. This can't be right.
Right.
You know, I was just in shock.
And you were you in? Were you saying why me? Because you were using condoms.
Yes.
Right. Okay.
Because I was very afraid of being, you know, catching HIV. So
right.
Pretty much, I knew I was being safe about it. I wasn't one of these people that were just letting anybody, you know, just do what they wanted with no condom on. So.
Okay. So, did you go through the stage? Because I don't even know what the stages are. Because I didn't go through them. So did you go through the stages of denial and all that stuff?
Not at all. Like I said, because I'd already told myself that it was what it was.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, pretty much when I found out, there was only the initial shock.
Mm-hmm.
And that's pretty much as far as it went. I mean, to this day, I haven't even cried because of it. I mean, I couldn't cry. Even if I wanted to, I couldn't. So, I mean, the only thing that really happened is I couldn't sleep in my own bed in my room, you know,
right.
For 2 weeks. I couldn't be in my apartment. I stayed with my partner at the time. I was always at his house for 2 weeks straight, you know.
Okay. How did your partner take it?
Huh?
Now, were you with somebody when you found out you were positive?
No, at the time that I found out, I was not with my partner, because we were together for a 3-year span, but we were in the middle of a breakup when the person that I was dating in the middle of that breakup was where I got it from.
Okay.
But I did call my, you know, my ex-partner at the time, because we normally wouldn't have got tested. So I asked him to go with me.
Mm-hmm.
And when we went, I came back positive. He came back negative.
Okay.
And I mean, at the time, he was shocked and very hurt for me. But I mean, surprisingly, that same night, he asked me to be back in a relationship with him that night.
Wow. Now, are you guys friends now?
Yes, we're friends now.
Okay, good. So, YouTube. No, let's back up. Because you've worked in HIV services as a, was it a case manager?
No, I was a prevention worker and a counselor.
Okay,
a
prevention worker. So let's talk about prevention as it pertains to us, mm-hmm. Blacks and Latinos. I know here in California that the message of prevention and education couldn't be more paramount for any state, for this country, for that matter. Here in California, our governor gutted our education and prevention, so there are no education and prevention messages being put out there. I don't know what it's like there in Florida. How important do you think a message of education and prevention is for people who are greatly hit by HIV and AIDS, particularly Blacks and Latinos and women of color?
It's very much important. That's my main point of even being here on YouTube, to do what I'm doing. Because honestly, I feel the place that I was working for, as well as any of the other agencies here, are really not pushing to do any kind of prevention. Like I said, the place that I worked for, they were just targeting to the gay community in general.
Right.
Really, you didn't see many prevention things going. We had a couple of intervention programs that we did, which I was a part of one of them.
Mm-hmm.
But pretty much, we had to basically sell our intervention by glamorizing it and putting half-naked men on the flyers just to get people to even want to come. So pretty much the agency that I work for, the directors are more concerned with getting the numbers that they can get of people who are coming to our drop-in center or coming in for services, more than they were really concerned with doing any prevention messages. So pretty much they were concerned just about numbers. It really wasn't about getting the message and spreading the word.
Right. Because I think if you get the message to one person, then you've done something. It doesn't make any sense if you have a room of 200 people and 200 people are not getting the message.
Exactly.
If you could get it to one person, then I think you've done something. So do you still have ties with that organization?
No, I don't. I go there every now and then to the drop-in center that I used to work for, but that's just generally to see some of the people that I used that I connected to while I was working there. Because I made a promise to those people when I worked there that I would be there for them to talk to them or help them through something. So I will drive every now and then to see those people that come up there. But I mean, as far as me going for any of the services or activities that the agency itself throws, no, I'm not there for that.
Okay. In speaking with you earlier on the phone, you experienced a lot of the same things I did as far as obstacles and barriers, and then finding out things like ADAP, you got to be sicker before you can actually qualify for it. Explain some of the hardships that you've had since you've been positive.
Oh, let me tell you something. These ASOs and these people make you want to just go and slit their throat with a rusted butter knife. I mean, I tell you. Because they want you to be damn near dead before they help you with anything that you need. You basically got to turn into a psycho and show up there every day, raise a stand and acting a damn fool to get what you need. I mean, it's ridiculous.
Right.
We need the help now while we're healthy. We're not trying to wait till we damn near dead and have an AIDS diagnosis before we can receive any kind of assistance. So I really think some things need to change. They really need to change. Because, I mean, like I said, I was running into the problems trying to see what's going on with ADAP. And, you know, when I got evicted from my previous apartment, trying to get housing assistance so that I could save my apartment, they gave me the runaround on that. And I still ended up getting evicted for them to call me 2 months later with, oh, we can help you save your apartment. It's like, it's too late now, bitch. What you go, you know, you can't help me now.
But, that's funny that you mentioned that because it's like, you hear that those programs are there and they're there to help you. But the programs, what you don't hear is that these programs are badly broken, poorly ran, and something like that. You were actually in an apartment. They call you 2 months after your eviction.
Exactly.
And it's like, what more can you do? You've done everything. You made them aware of the problem. You stayed on top of the problem, and you still get evicted. And then they call you 2 months later. What was their response after you were just like, well, it's too late?
They just looked at me. I was on the phone, but they just said, oh, well, they didn't even say, oh, sorry to hear that. They just said, oh, well, if you find a new apartment, we can help you with the down payment. I'm like, if I find a new apartment, I pretty much wouldn't need it. That means I have money and access. I wouldn't need help with the down payment. I needed help to save myself from being evicted.
Right.
So if I found a new apartment, obviously I won't need you guys' help with the damn down payment.
Right, and even if you found a new apartment with that eviction on your record, you're going to have to contend with a little bit more than just getting into the apartment.
Exactly, and that's two evictions I have now, so really they didn't help me none at all. Because I was trying to save myself from having to go through that.
Right. So now you're back at home with your mother.
Oh, yes I am.
And your mother doesn't know about your status, has selective amnesia when it comes to you being gay. What's your living situation like?
Pretty much I have to walk on eggshells around my mother 24/7 because, I mean, everything I do, that's gay. That's not what a man would do. But in my mind, it's like, first of all, you're a woman. How are you going to tell me what's manly and what's not? You're
right.
A woman. But, I mean, I'm sleeping on a couch, which I'm not going to complain because I could be sleeping on the road or, you know, in my car. So I am thankful for that. But it's like my mother is my mother has a lot of anger in her heart. I don't know where it comes from, and I just try to pray for her. But pretty much my mother is just, everything I do is a screw up to her. I mean, I could be floating around there like an angel with a halo over my head, sweeping, cooking, and cleaning, and being Betty Crocker and Donna Reed, mm-hmm. and it's still not good enough for her. So, right. You know, pretty much I just take it with a grain of salt. I'm barely home during the day. I go home when it's time to go to sleep. So therefore, I really don't have to deal with my mother too much. I try to keep it that way.
Okay. So when we come back, I promise, we're going to talk about your YouTube channel.
All right.
When we come back.